أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم to everyone who's here and who is watching over the internet. Today I'll be discussing chapter 4 verses 58 and 59. Inna Allaha ya'murukum an tu'addul amanati ila ahliha wa iza hakamtum bainan nasi an tahkumu bil adli inna Allaha Nema yuhazzikum bihi inna allaha kana samiyum basira. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu atiullaha wa atiur rasulova wa ulil amre minkum fa in tanazitum fi shayin farudduhu ilallahi wa rasuli in kuntum tuminuna billahi wal yawmil akhiri. ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ وَأَحْسَنُ تَأْوِيلًا. Surely Allah commands you to make over trusts to those worthy of them, and that when you judge between people, you judge with justice. Surely Allah admonishes you with what is excellent. Surely Allah is ever hearing and ever seeing. O you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger and those in authority from among you. Then if you quarrel about anything, refer it to Allah and the Messenger. If you believe in Allah and the last day, this is the best and the more suitable to achieve the end. The beauty of the Holy Quran is that it lays down such general principles for the conduct of human life that they can be applied at any time, in any place, by any people. These principles are not restricted by time or space. And this is why God deliberately did not reveal every little detail. It was left to the Holy Prophet Muhammad to tell us what the detailed implementation of these rules and regulations is going to be. The first part of what I read to you is, surely Allah commands you to make over your trusts to those worthy of them. Now, in the conduct of human affairs, you have to have people who make decisions for you. They may be prime ministers, they may be presidents, they may be the executive of a community or a voluntary organization. It may even be a family. But in each and every case where you have a collection of people living together, there has to be an organization. You have to have some means of making decisions. Even in a family where you have husband and wife and children and so on, someone has to make a decision. Otherwise, things won't get done. They may be simple decisions. What are we going to have for lunch? Where are we going on Friday or Saturday? There may be major decisions. Are we going to move house? Are we going to go and live in a different country and so on? Whether the decision is major or minor, at the end of the day, someone has to make it. And the same applies to organizations. Whether a decision is big or it's small, someone has to make that decision. The question then is, who should that person or those people be? And you have basically two or three systems that you can implement in a society. On the one hand, you can have some kind of, call it dictatorship, call it monarchy, call it autocracy, call it what you will, but where one person makes a decision. And that person takes the power, grabs the power, is given the power, as the monarchs in the days of old were regarded as having been appointed by God. Or the other alternative is for people to find those to whom they're going to entrust their affairs. Not everyone can decide on which side of the road you're going to drive. Not everyone can decide whether more hospitals are required or more schools are required or more old people's homes are required. You need to entrust those decisions. So as I said, there are two ways of doing it. One, all of us jointly find someone and say, well, that person or that group of people are going to take these decisions on our behalf. And this is the method that is recommended in the Holy Quran by Allah. But who should those people be? What qualities should they have? We find generally that a community entrusts its decisions to the people they elect, and they elect them on the basis of the promises they make, or how clever they are, or how they come across on television or radio. As we are seeing these days that there is an election going on in the United States, and there is such emphasis on how the candidates come across to people on the television. So one approach is that of presentation, not what those people are about, but how do they come across and what promises they make. And the other approach is the Islamic one, and that you, Allah commands you to make over your trust. Who to those worthy of them. Iqbal had said rightly, Allama Sir Muhammad Iqbal, that he referring to Western democracy, he said, "Jamhuriyat wo tarze hukumat hai ke jisme bandon ko gina karte hain, tola nahi karte." That Western democracy is the form of government in which you simply count people. You don't see what they are worth or whether they are worthy of something. And it's very strange that when someone is elected and then they go back on their promises, people complain. Well, when you elected that person, did you take his character into account? You see, I find this a very strange concept in the Western world, that you have a person's character, a leader's character, divided into two separate parts. There is his personal life, and then there is his public life. He can do whatever he likes in his personal life, as long as he's okay in his public life. Now, supposing, as frequently happens in the West, that in his personal life, this leader is cheating on his wife. He's lying to her. Would you really expect him not to cheat you and me? Would you really expect him to be honest and truthful to us? He's lying to the person closest to him. He's lying to the person, perhaps, who's the mother of his children. If he's lying to someone so close to him, why do you expect him to be truthful to you and me? There is duty there as a husband to his wife. He's not doing that duty. There is a connection of love and affection. He's betraying that connection of love and affection. But what I'm told is that as long as he's in his public life, he's okay. Forget about his personal life. Well, how can you? Human beings are not cut into two things. It's like the example I gave last week of people saying, well, keep your religion in your home and don't bring it out. And this is what Islam says, that when you elect someone, don't elect them on the basis of the promises they make. Because no one is going to promise you hardship. Is there a politician who says that if you elect me, your life is going to be very hard, it's going to be very difficult? He may know it's going to be very hard and very difficult. He may know that people might have to lose their jobs. He may know that the country's economy is going to collapse and bankrupt hundreds of businesses or thousands of businesses. But will he say so? No, he won't. Because people want them to paint a rosy picture. Elect me, I'll save jobs, I'll save businesses, I'll do this, I'll do that. And then, because we depend on these promises and don't consider whether these people are actually worthy of being elected to these high offices, whether these people are actually worthy that we entrust our affairs to them, that we are let down over and over again. And in Islamic terms, it is very difficult. It is almost impossible to be worthy of this heavy burden of the leadership of a country. And Muslims of the companions of the Holy Prophet and Muslims of earlier times would actually shirk this responsibility because the weight of it was so great. There are many examples, particularly from Hazrat Umar. In one instance, it is said that one of his policies was to continue whatever Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala had started. And Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala asked, what did Abu Bakr used to do? And they told him he did this. And one of the things was that Hazrat Abu Bakr used to personally take food to a person who lived in the cave. So Hazrat Umar found out who this person was, and he took this man his food and put this in front of him and said, this is your evening meal, this is your dinner. And the man said, has Abu Bakr passed on? And Hazrat Umar said, how do you know? And he said, Abu Bakr knew that I am blind. And he wouldn't just put the food in front of me. He would break it up and feed me. You have just put this food in front of me. So I realized it wasn't Abu Bakr. And I realized that he would never miss one single day of bringing me food. This is the person who's worthy of becoming an Islamic leader. There were rebellions, there were revolts, there were people who were refusing to pay zakat and so on and so forth. And amongst all of that, there was a community to be organized and led. There were negotiations with the powers on the borders of Arabia. There were armies to be raised to defend the borders of what is now Saudi Arabia. And yet amongst all of that, Hazrat Abu Bakr radhiyallahu ta'ala did not forget that a part of his duty was to feed this person. And he would, every day he would find time and he would go and do it. There is another example when Hazrat Abu Bakr radhiyallahu ta'ala passed on. They read out his will. Now when Hazrat Abu Bakr became Khalifa, he wanted to continue with his business. He was a merchant, he used to buy and sell cloth. And Hazrat Umar persuaded him to give that up because of the heavy burden of the work of the state and accept something from the treasury to meet his expenses. So when his will was read out, the first thing it said was, he mentioned a specific property that is to be sold, and this is the amount that I took from public treasury to feed myself and myself in the approximately 2.5 years that I was the Khalifa, and I regarded that as a loan from the Muslim Ummah to Abu Bakr. So first that has to be read. And when this was read out, Hazrat Umar fell to the ground and he cried. And he said, oh Abu Bakr, how shall I follow this example that you have set us? He was so careful that he did not believe that the head of state should take a penny from the public treasury. But because there was no other way of feeding his family, he took it as a loan. And the first thing that was to be done is to repayment of the treasury, and then anything else was to go to his family and so on and so forth. So these are the people who are worthy of being leaders. One day Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala was sitting on the floor and he was crying. And people went to him and they said, Umar, you are such a pious man, you are a saint, you look after everyone, so why are you crying? And Hazrat Umar said, do you know the burden that I bear? And they said, yes, but you discharge that burden so well. And he said, no, if a dog on the borders of river Euphrates dies of hunger, I'm answerable for that dog's death. How many people in what we call Islamic countries are dying these days? They're dying of hunger. They're dying of thirst because they don't have clean water. They're dying of disease because they don't have clean water. They're dying of breathing difficulties because they don't even have clean air anymore. And how many of the rulers tremble in their shoes and weep and lament and cry at night that they are answerable for those deaths. There was a time when there was a famine in Saudi Arabia at the time of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Hazrat Umar's first decree was that from today, all punishment for stealing food is abolished until this famine is over. And people said, "O Umar, this punishment is written in the Holy Quran." And he said, "Yes, but Umar who cannot feed his people, Umar who cannot feed his people has no right to punish them when they steal food to fill their bellies." These are the people who are worthy. And these are the people who made Islam great. And these are the people who made Muslims great. And these are the people whose example was seen by other nations. And they wanted to become Muslims. How many examples can we give from the early history of Islam? There is that famous one, that when Muslim army surrounded Jerusalem, a message was sent to the commander. And the governor of the city and the religious elders said, "If your leader personally comes to Jerusalem and guarantees our safety, we'll hand over the keys of our city to him without fight. Without a fight. But he must come personally." And when this message got to Medina, Hazrat Umar set off. Now, these days, when a Muslim leader goes from A to B, when they go from, if you take the example of Pakistan, from Islamabad to Rawalpindi, have you seen their entourage? Have you seen the number of bulletproof cars? Have you seen the number of roads that are blocked off? Have you seen the number of ambulances who can't take the sick and the needy to hospital because some leader, some prime minister, some president is going to pass down this road in the next 2 or 3 hours? Sometimes there are 20 or 30 cars, all bulletproof, each one of them costing £2 million or so. And that is just one trip I'm talking. The great Umar, how many people did he have? There were two who set off from Medina. This master of Saudi Arabia, this master of what is now Egypt and Sudan, this master of what is now Jordan and Syria and Israel and Lebanon, whose armies were knocking on the doors of India and China, whose armies had defeated the Persian Empire and the Byzantinian Empire, when he set off from Medina, how many people did he have? How many hundreds of camels did he have? He had one camel. It was Hazrat Umar and a servant who went on this journey. And look at his sense of justice. Look at his respect for humanity and equality. He had a slave with him. They had one camel. So he said, "We will take it in turns to ride the camel. You are my slave, but you have as much right to rest as I have." If Hazrat Umar rode the camel for 1 hour and the slave walked for an hour. Then the slave rode the camel for 1 hour and Umar walked for an hour. This is what made these people worthy. And these greats and nobles and Jerusalem, they would come out of their city and they look and see when this great caravan will arrive with the head of this mighty state. And one day they saw two riders coming and one camel. And Muslims told them that our leader has arrived. And they ran to greet that leader. And they went and they got him off the camel. But it was the slave's turn to ride the camel as they approached Jerusalem. So the great Umar, he was walking in front and the slave was riding the camel. So when we say that these people embraced Islam, it wasn't by reading translations of the Holy Quran that they embraced Islam. It was by seeing these people who lived Islam. Is there another example in the world of this equal treatment? You see, when Western critics, they criticize Islam, they say Islam didn't abolish slavery. But Islamic slavery wasn't the slavery that you saw in southern states of America. It was this slavery. When the head of state walked and the slave rode the camel. And these are the people that Quran talks about when it says, make your trusts over, make your hand your affairs, put your affairs in the hands of those people who are worthy of them. It's people who feel their responsibility. And you cannot feel your responsibility unless you realize there is accountability. Unless you know that one day you'll be answerable for your actions. There are lots of people who don't steal. Why? Because they'll be answerable. They'll be caught on the surveillance video. The police will come. They'll get arrested. They'll go to prison. There is accountability. That is why lots of people don't do wrong. But unless you believe, as the Quran says at the very beginning, that you believe in the day of judgment, you believe in that day when you will be held accountable for all your deeds, unless you really truly believe that, unless it is ingrained in your heart, you will not do the right thing. You will not be worthy of becoming a leader of the Ummah. These heavy tasks are not easy to discharge. It is said that there is an incident that someone had a dream about the Day of Judgment, or Hazrat Umar being presented to Allah to account for his deeds. And he says, Hazrat Umar was presented to Allah. And I waited and Hazrat Umar came out. And I asked him, I said, "Oh Umar, how did God treat you?" And he said, "I was surprised that Hazrat Umar was trembling. He was perspiring." So he said, "What happened? How did God treat you?" And Hazrat Umar said, "Had it not been for God's mercy and beneficence." This is the great Umar radiallahu ta'ala. This is the man about whom God has said, "I am pleased with him and he is pleased with me." His reply is, "Had it not been for God's mercy and his beneficence, I would have been cast into hell. So now let's look at ourselves. Let's look at those people who put themselves forward to become our leaders. What is their character? Are they worthy that they put on Umar's mantle? Are they worthy that they put on Abu Bakr's mantle? Are they worthy? If they're not worthy, then why are they doing it? Surely there can only be one reason, and that is that they hanker after some material benefit. There is something in it for them, not for you, not for me. And if that is why they are doing it, then surely in their heart of hearts they don't believe that there is a day of judgment. In their heart of hearts they don't believe that there is accountability. In their heart of hearts they don't believe that one day they will have to account for all the wrongs that they did. One day they will be asked. If an infant in Quetta dies because of hunger or because of disease, whoever the president or the prime minister or the leader is of that nation, they will be asked, it was your responsibility. And that responsibility wasn't thrust on you by God. You voluntarily, you stepped forward and you said, give me this duty. Entrust this task to me and I will fulfill it. How much greater is that burden? You don't have any excuse. You can't say, I didn't want to do it. I wasn't capable of doing it. It was thrust upon me. You know, when God said to the Holy Prophet Muhammad, I'm entrusting to you this task of reformation of the whole of humanity. The Holy Prophet didn't have any choice. God commanded and he had to obey. But how much more responsible you're going to be held if you put yourself forward and you say, I'm better than that one or that one or that one. I can fulfill your needs. I can feed the hungry. I can provide medical treatment for the sick and so on. And as I said to you, in early days of Islam, Muslims used to try and shy away from this responsibility. They used to say, let him be the Khalifa. Let him be the Khalifa. Don't give this responsibility to me. Why? Because they believed in their heart of hearts, they actually believed, they had iman, that one day they will have to account for whatever it is that they do. And those who don't have that faith, they are not worthy that we hand over our trusts to them. So let us pray today that may God give our leaders the wisdom to live up in accordance with the teachings of the Holy Quran, and may God make them worthy that people may entrust their affairs to them. And may God make them examples like our elders from days of yore, whom other nations and people saw, that they were such living embodiments of fine principles of Islam that they would run to join this religion. May these people also become living and shining example of a living Islam, which has the solution to all of humanity's problems.